It's often said that two things in our lives are constant, and that's death and taxes. Whatever unprecedented changes are confronting us now and the economy that we live in, it does seem that death and taxes are the two constants we all have to plan for. Today, we're going to pick up on one of these areas, the one we least like to talk about, which is our own mortality and how we can plan around this part of our investment and life journeys. Now, while we all might like to think that we are invincible, we do have to make sure that we protect and preserve our wealth and minimize the impact of any untimely departure from this world. One way to do this is through life cover, and that's what we're going to be discussing today. My two guests from Investec are the perfect people to help us consider what we do in this very sensitive area. I'm joined by Jonathan Hillier, who is a financial advisor at Investec, also joined by Snenhlanhla Sithomo, head of Investec's life insurance business. Now, Jonathan has been a financial advisor for a very long time, helping clients achieve and manage their financial planning goals. A big part of his life is staying fit, or trying to at least, certainly does enjoy throwing around some weights in the CrossFit gym. You also might find him at your nearest golf course, chasing around a little white ball around a field until it goes into a hole. He's also married to the most amazing wife. He does say that he's married up, and they have a daughter of 9 months, and certainly a gentleman who is very close to his faith and lives much of his life according to the Bible and its central theme. Also joined by Snenhlanhla Sithomo, who's been at Investec for about 7 years or so. And Snenhlanhla says selling insurance is no different to selling a pack of sprouts. Nobody wants it, but both are certainly always good for you. He plays some squash and comes from the small town of Escort out in the Midlands. And you might certainly see him soon at the Trevor Noah show if you're going to be heading to those parts very soon. So, Jonathan and Snenhlanhla, young professionals like ourselves certainly don't like to think about mortality. We also, of course, as many of our listeners in this podcast series would know, that some of us younger people certainly have a much greater appetite for risk. So why would I want to take all of this much needed wealth into a life cover product, Jonathan, when I could be putting it into a much riskier instrument and probably realizing much higher returns?
Thanks very much, Ayobonga, for the opportunity to be on the podcast and chat to you. So I think, to your point around the fact that young professionals generally want to hope for the best, in terms of living a long, prosperous life, and so they should. But the saying goes that, one should hope for the best, but plan for the worst. And often in a client considering life insurance, it feels like if you're paying for life insurance today, it's a waste of money because, hey, I can look at taking it out in 20 years' time when I'm older and it may appear more relevant. But to your point around, well, I can get a better return in an investment if I basically self-insure, the truth of the matter is that it would take you many, many years to invest enough money to generate the cover that you would actually have in the event of you passing away. So if you were to contribute a monthly premium to an investment, you'd have to probably invest that money for between maybe 40 and 50 years before you actually accumulate enough wealth in terms of the cover that you may need today. So life insurance, or life cover for that matter, basically upfronts that cover to you today in the event of something happening to you tomorrow, which would have otherwise taken many, many years to achieve.
Mm-hmm. And Snenhlanhla, you were saying that life cover, certainly for younger professionals, is probably one of the most efficient or cost-efficient forms of hedging one of these very, very, I guess, constant risks, and that is the risk that one will pass on, or even any other risks, severe illness, disability, and so on, that might affect one's earning potential.
Yes, I mean, when you're thinking about your investment portfolio, it's very, very usual that you look at your expected return versus the risk you're taking. So you're balancing the risk and the return. And insurance by nature is one of those most efficient and probably cost-effective mechanisms to include in your portfolio or to protect your portfolio and yourself by better balancing that. So as Jonathan was giving an example earlier with death or life cover benefits, you pay a very, very small premium for a potential very, very large payout if something adverse were to happen to you. And for me, I think you have to consider that as part of your overall portfolio. You do have your other investments in other various asset classes. Insurance is one of those that can really ensure that protection in a much more cost-effective manner in terms of the small premium you pay. But also the second part to the other side of the coin for me is it's not always about death. I think South Africans, we are very, very obsessed and fascinated about death, and we are sometimes overly insured for death payouts, but we ignore and forget sometimes about disabilities and the severe illnesses that can happen. And especially if you are a young professional in South Africa, you are more likely to actually be disabled through a car accident than to die of anything. And that's just the reality. So if you actually protect yourself also for events of disabilities, you're making sure that your investment goals will still carry on even if you're unable to work or unable to look after yourself, but those will continue to be taken care of, because it doesn't mean that you're dead. It means that you're just unable to work anymore.
You know, you make a very important point. And somebody once said to me, you know, South Africans plan more for death than for any other risk that might unfold, which might mean you're still alive, but you know, it really, you know, takes a knock on your earning potential. It seems insurance cover in a way does, I guess, two things. The one is the whole sort of hedging element, which is around really, I guess, trying to smooth the risks associated with any discontinuity or shock to one's earning life, if I can call it that, across their working life. But then there's the other element around the impact that that might have on the intergenerational transfer of wealth were one to die. Talk to me about these two elements, and Jonathan, you might also want to come in here. One, the hedging side, but also, I guess, the wealth preservation. So, Stenhlanhla, I'll start with you, and then we'll come back to you, Jonathan.
Yeah, so I think with any person, their aspirations will always be a building blocks or a journey towards something. So what you find when it comes to financial services or it comes to wealth creation is that you are building your wealth towards a specific goal or towards a specific journey. As you go through that journey, typically your life stage is changing. You're also a young professional. You're going to start having a family. Kids are going out of to school, to university, and they're out of your home. And your wealth creation journey is also progressively updating or growing with that. So what then happens is if something does happen to you that is adverse, because sometimes, as Jonathan was saying earlier on, you plan for the best, but sometimes something happens along the way. So let's just say there is an accident, there is a disability that happens. What we speak about when you say insurance can be used as a hedging tool is saying you do have these clear specific goals that you want to retire at age 65 with a specific amount that you can draw an income from. Or you want to build this property portfolio of X number of properties that will be able to draw an income from in the future. Or you want to take your kids to a university or to an overseas university at some point in the future. You are assuming, you're making a very big assumption at that point, that between now and then, you'll be perfectly healthy. You'll be perfectly able to earn an income and be able to fund that investment those investment goals. And this hedging tool is basically protecting that journey and that investment plan, so making sure that it gets fulfilled regardless of what may happen to you. I mean, the worst will be even if you do die no longer around, that's when the death benefit comes in. But for me, it's the building blocks of this hedging tool. It's not just one instrument, of which is the death benefits. It's also a severe illness, or what we call dread disease, a payout. You suffer a cancer. You're focusing on your cancer recovery, but your investment plan and looking after your kids and your future goals should still continue what you're battling with your cancer and probably surviving the cancer. Same thing if you become disabled. So that's what we mean by a hedging tool in using insurance. And then maybe I'll hand over to Jonathan to just take us through the thinking about the wealth preserver, because that's later on then once you've created that wealth and making it intergenerational. But for me, it's very, very important that we do make a lot of assumptions about us being able to fulfill our goals, because we look at the market, we look at what we invest in and all those nice things, but we forget about what if the worst were to happen to us.
Yeah. Jonathan?
Yeah, thanks. I think, first of all, it's very important to understand that every person's individual financial planning needs are different. So there's never a one-size-fits-all recommendation. from a life insurance perspective. And your financial advisor or financial planner needs to understand your personal circumstances before he makes any recommendations. And I often see too often in the industry, there's kind of a blanket approach to young professionals in terms of, you know, the recommendations that are sometimes made. And that's certainly not the case. And I think, you know, to the points that have been made, as you are building your wealth, that you have a long-term view of that. And you know that, or potentially have a goal of achieving X in 10 or 15 years' time. What happens if that doesn't come to fruition? In terms of if you get disabled today, if you pass away today, how are you going to protect your legacy? And the best way to do that is through life insurance. For example, today you might be a young professional earning a certain salary, and you may have some financial dependents who require or are dependents on you providing for them. In the event of X, Y, and Z, what is going to happen to that income? And as I was alluding to, it's different for every person's circumstances. So if you are no longer around, or you are unable to earn a level of income, insurance or life insurance is generally the best way of providing for that. That's just one example where life insurance plays a critical role in wealth preservation. Another example would be if you've accumulated some level of wealth, you need to make sure that if you pass away, as an example, that wealth is protected. There can be things like estate duty, capital gains tax, executive fees, a whole lot of costs that can come into your estate that would effectively erode that wealth in the event of death. And life insurance or life cover, in this example, would be the best way of protecting your wealth. So those are some simple examples that I can give to answer your question.
Jonathan, you've touched on something very important there, which of course is that intergenerational question and the implication of all of these risks that we must insure and hedge against for estate planning purposes. I guess the other element is probably the second constant, which is taxes. Talk to me about the tax efficiency just of payouts of the sort, because that's something that often doesn't feature as much in the discussion.
So life insurance in terms of the actual payout is tax-free across the board. So whether that's life cover, severe illness, disability, or income protection payouts are all paid out tax-free. However, from a life cover perspective, depending on who those beneficiaries are, will, and the level of payout and the structure of your estate, will potentially attract different taxes, specifically estate duty, which is effectively a tax on death. So the government doesn't only tax us when we're alive, unfortunately they also tax us when we pass away. So there has to be careful planning specifically around life cover in the event of death because of the potential estate duty implications that can come into play. In effect, at a simple level, if your estate is worth more than 3.5 million rand, your net estate, it can be estate dutable at 20% depending on how you've left your estate. And that can include the life cover payouts. So if your life cover pays out to your estate, and your total estate is worth more than 3.5 million, it is estate dutable at 20% up to 30 million and then above 35 million at 25%. So that's where estate duty can come into play. And as I was saying, that's effectively a death tax that the government can levy. And the thing is, if estate duty is levyable on that life cover policy, whoever the beneficiary is receiving that policy would be liable to pay that estate duty.
You mentioned a few really important issues, which is, of course, those who stand to inherit, while the payout itself might not necessarily be taxable, there might be some estate duties associated with that as an inheritance tax of sort. And Stentlatla, this brings me, I guess, to an earlier comment you made, which is we have to think of these elements in holistic fashion. So it's not just about life insurance. There are many other, you know, forms of insurance at a product level that would complement life cover as we're discussing it. I'd like you maybe to continue on that vein.
Yeah, Yes, and I think that's a very important point, Ayabonga, because especially in early in your career as a young professional, sometimes you might not have even dependents or your own children and spouse to look after if something you had to die. So it does mean that your needs may also mean that your biggest risk you face is if you are disabled or you get a severe illness. And I'll also just make a quick example for females. The prevalence of breast cancer, I mean, even in your 20s and your 30s, you are at elevated risk of a breast cancer. Albeit it could be at a lower stages, like stage 1 or stage 2 cancers, but those could still be expensive in treating them, but also in disrupting your life for a couple of months or a year. And for me, if you don't have dependents, as Jonathan was saying earlier on, everything is around your circumstances. If you don't have dependents, you do not necessarily need to be taking a life cover, but you should be focusing on things that are you really expose you financially. And severe illness, for example, and a disability cover are one of those insurance solutions that I think could and should be playing a bigger role in South African financial planning and for individuals. And that, for me, is also one of the barriers. I think most people don't understand insurance to its full potential, into its full solution mode, because they just think about life cover and death benefits and funeral cover instead of thinking holistically.
Mm-hmm. And you know, I mean, to your point, oncology treatments of whatever cancer really don't come cheap, but we are also seeing many forms of illnesses over and above the non sort of or unnatural causes of death. But seeing more and more younger people now suffering from strokes, suffering from ailments that we often associate with much older people. But to the point that both of you have been making, and I'm interested in hearing your thoughts on this, it does seem to me that this is not just some purchase of off-the-shelf Brussels sprouts, but there is a particular level of customization to one's circumstances that must inform the choice at a product level of what one decides on. Jonathan, your thoughts on this, and Desmond Chantla, I'll also like you to come back on this one as well. If it's about getting a customized solution, it does mean that it's not just about picking one product off the shelf, but also about a much thoroughgoing discussion with somebody who can handhold me through this process.
No, it is. And it's, you know, life insurance is, it is actually a very personal thing. Because you generally are going down into, you know, you're questioning a lot of things around a person's desires and aspirations, his family circumstances, and you know, sometimes it's not the most comfortable thing to talk about, especially when it comes to death or any kind of ailment for that matter. But it's a necessary conversation. And it's our jobs as financial planners or financial advisors to really unearth that in a client and help them participate in that conversation. Because, you know, in my experience, clients are not wanting to be as forthcoming when it comes to really expressing what their needs are or what their wants are. They kind of give you the generic response. And actually you want to try and read between the lines in terms of what they really are saying. And the truth is that only kind of really comes with time and experience in terms of reading and understanding clients and body language. It's not something that you just learn because you learned you got a qualification at university. To be honest, it really just comes with dealing with people over time and understanding how they operate and dealing with many kinds of different cultures and people and just with backgrounds, and you need life experience and you need time in the seat in terms of seeing people in order to understand all of that, and then once you've got a full picture of all of those facets, you can give a contextualized financial plan.
To add to that, I think for me it's also looking at the complexities that I think we'll encounter when you're looking at the insurance solutions in the market. I'll make an example of if you already unearth and you found that you do need a car, you don't just then go out and say, I'll just buy any, that next car I'll see on through the window if I go shopping for a car. You then have to look at what is suitable for you. Are you looking for a family car? Are you looking for a small car? Are you looking for a fuel-efficient car? Are you looking for a performance car? So I think in the insurance space, it becomes even more complex because of the bells and whistles that you find in there. But more so for me, it's also you could potentially buy a product that will lock you in, for example, with an expectation that you're going to be holding this product for the next 20, 30 years, but you actually need a product to protect for your family home for the next 20 years. So it might not necessarily be appropriate then to take a much longer product. So all those technicalities about the product, that's where I guess also the financial planner or financial advisor plays a big role into guiding you into which one is more appropriate for you. And that in the end is where I think the cost of not getting proper advice and looking at these products appropriately comes in the long term, because you might be in an inappropriate product. The worst for me would be where on a severe illness or a disability product, you are on a product that really limits your chances of claiming. So you pay for quite a long time, but the chance of claiming for you are really, really diminished. So for me, that's really where an average person is not really a specialist in this area. That's where a financial advisor specializes in that. So it's not only just looking at your needs and whether you need the cover and how much you need, but looking at which product would be more appropriate for you.
You know, Statline, Jonathan made a very interesting point earlier on, which is, when you speak to somebody, they often give you the generic response. And similarly so, there would be a reluctance to disclose what cover one might have. God forbid somebody might want to, I guess, yeah, realize that cover via liquidating somebody. I hate to use that word. How is that dealt with within the framework of how cover is extended? So that kind of risk I don't know what to call it, perverse incentive of disclosing, not just yourselves as an advisor, but, you know, even to people that might be close to you and have an interest in that payout, should that payout materialize for whatever reason.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. I think Jonathan can also elaborate on this because he deals with the clients on a day-to-day basis. But it's an interesting one because, I mean, on the far extreme end, you'll have instances where it is a court order. That you are divorcing your wife, you need to take care of your wife, there must be a policy. So all parties will be clear about what the policy is, how much it's needed, and it's all apparent. On the other extreme hand is really where a breadwinner is taking out a specific cover amount. And in the insurance space, we speak about the concept of insurable interest. So where you take out the cover amount, sometimes there is a lot of reluctancy sometimes to disclose to the family how much the cover amount is, or that there is even a cover in place. I bet that they actually see themselves being enriched if something were to happen to you. So that's when also the conflicts of interest may arise. So those issues do cause some discomfort amongst clients when they think and they take up insurance about what do I disclose to the rest of the family and what could potentially put me at risk. So what we do as insurance providers is to make sure that we are very, very thorough in the insurable interest, that there is a very, very apparent and very, very justifiable insurable interest, because if it's not there, it could actually potentially put this client at risk. And then the other part for me is also what do we do with the payout once have been made? Who are the beneficiaries? And most of the time, it is up to the client to choose who the beneficiaries would be and how much each of the beneficiaries should take. But for me, those discussions are pretty much linked to that financial plan that the client and the advisor will go through. And just making sure that all those things are aligned to what these beneficiaries will need. And sometimes those conversations for me are not always as comfortable for clients to be discussing, which means the relationship between the planner, the financial planner and the clients is always has to be quite warm and quite strong for them to be comfortable to go through that journey.
Jonathan?
Yeah, I think obviously a level of trust needs to try and be established as soon as possible for the clients to feel comfortable to share as much as possible. But even with that trust established, there sometimes can be a barrier to disclosure from a client. And I think one of the things that I do to encourage full disclosure is to really give the landscape of a worst case scenario if there's not honest and upfront disclosure around, you know, what can happen in the event of X, Y, and Z. What are the costs of not telling me the full picture here? And once you paint the picture for the client, they understand that you're not there to necessarily try and push a product on them. You are there to give good advice around event X, Y, and Z. And that is a crucial element to the discussion. Again, too many times I see clients getting pushed with product before planning, and it should never be that way. The product sells itself when you bring in good financial planning so that the client understands the need for the product that you are then putting on the table.
Yeah. Jonathan and Snetlandla, I will not let this opportunity go to have two of you who have a wealth of knowledge, wisdom, and I guess experience with many of your clients. So I'm going to take this shot at getting some free advice. Jonathan, let me start off with you, and we'll end off with you, Snetlandla. If there's anything I should take from this discussion, and I must take this opportunity to get all the free advice I can get, what would that be? And I think the last nugget of wisdom you've shared, I think, is critical. That we have to start with the planning. We have to start with that assessment of where the need is. And then that automatically takes us to the product choice or the product selection process. So, Jonathan, any tips and nuggets of wisdom for me or any hacks that I can take while I still have you on the line for the next few minutes?
Well, I think, you know, the first one, which is probably pretty obvious considering I am an advisor, but is to obviously find a robust, experienced, knowledgeable advisor who can give you the proper financial planning that you need. And preferably, you'd want to be finding a certified financial planner who has been accredited through the Financial Planning Institute. And then you know that you're getting a certain level of service. And that is effectively the highest designation that one can achieve in the financial planning industry. And, you know, it's the same as sort of a chartered accountant in the accounting world. You know that you're getting a certain level of standard or level of service and advice. So I think that would be sort of one pearl of wisdom that I could impart to clients, is to try and find a certified financial planner who has some years of experience, and you should then be getting a good level of service and advice.
I think for me there are two points to maybe summarize. One is we always think insurance is for older people, and I do think as soon as you are working and you've got an investment plan or you're accumulating wealth, you're never too old to consider insurance. And then the second part is, for me, it's not always about death. There are a lot of other eventualities that you actually need to think about, and I don't think it's always top of mind to think about those eventualities and those risks.
Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure chatting to the pair of you. I certainly will have to pick up the phone soon and give one of you, if not both of you, a call just based on what we've discussed today. But thank you very much for so generously sharing of your time.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
So that's it, folks, for this episode of our Wealth Creation Podcast here on Investec Focus Radio in our second season, of course, and that's the tail end of episode 7. Big thank you to my two guests, Jonathan Hillier and Snetlandla Sitomo, and for myself, Ayabonga Tawe, till we meet again.
The views expressed are those of the contributors at the time of publication and do not necessarily represent the views of Investec Wealth and Investment International, and should not be taken as advice, guidance, or recommendation. Investec Wealth and Investment International, a member of the JSE Equity, Equity Derivatives, Currency Derivatives, Bond Derivatives, and Interest Rate Derivatives Markets, an authorized financial services provider and a registered credit provider.